Right, if you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 16, and we'll begin reading in verse 11. And I love that song, and I can comprehend when prayer will no longer be necessary. Mark 16, verse 11. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. After that, he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and he upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe in the name. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues. They that take up serpents, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven, and sat on the right hand of God, and went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. I'd like to preach this morning, the Lord being my helper, on the thought, I believe. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We thank you for your blessings that you send time to time. Lord, we praise you for the Holy Spirit, Lord, for how it speaks to us, how it makes thy word more than just words on a page, but a living word, and one that we can follow, and one that can be our life's guide, and one that can speak life to others. Lord, we pray now that you would honor your word. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now this morning I'll be preaching and teaching on problems of unbelief. Now, I'll say this first as we get started. One thing, and I treasure all the truths of this Bible, but don't ever let the Bible interfere with you believing. Don't ever let the Bible, and by that I mean he's still able, and he still saves, and you don't know the elect, so just believe. Amen. Believe that he is able. Pray for those that are lost, and leave it at the feet of Jesus. And never attribute anything to any other thing but just belief. You know why you're here this morning? It's because of belief. You know why you're saved? It's because of belief. That is the stemming of all things, is true belief. Now, I want you to see we have a measure of unbelief by the apostles. Now, when I say this, they heard of many things, and they chose not to believe. Now, at Sovereign Grace Baptist, sometimes we get a little shaky, but you know what? Your belief does matter. Your belief will impact your service. Your belief or your lack of belief will either paralyze you or make you continue on when everything looks black. Belief does matter. Belief is very important to the life of a true believer. And so starting in verse 11, and they, meaning the apostles themselves. Now what had happened, Mary had come back from the garden. She had had this experience with Christ. She had seen him living after the resurrection. And she went and told just as she was supposed to. In fact, she was directed of the angel, go tell his brethren. And then the Lord himself said, go tell my brethren. Tell them that I have risen from the dead. Now I ask you this morning, do you believe that? And certainly I hope you do. If you don't believe that, I would say this, you're not saved. Because salvation hinges completely on the fact, do you believe or do you not believe? Have you confidence in what the Lord said? So she gets back and shares the gospel with them. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. Now that's a problem, is it not? That's a difficulty. And we'll see at the very end of this, he gives the Great Commission. And what the Great Commission really hinges on is this, is belief. Is it not? Do you have confidence that others will be saved? Do you have faith that there's still some out there that no doubt will be those that fall on good ground and will bring up fruit that will be pleasing unto the Lord? And I believe that. If I did not believe that, I would give up right now. I would be done. I would be finished. If I didn't believe that, and God be my helper, I'm just being honest, I would quit. I really would. And you know what? I would have to say, at least in a man's eyes, I'd be justified in doing it. Because there's no belief. If there's no hope without belief, then there's nothing. So I want you to see what their unbelief did. I bet, and again, I don't have to speculate from the Bible, but don't you think it was a discouragement to Mary? I bet it was. Did she feel foolish? Did she feel discouraged? I'm sure she did. And so we find that when we make these broad statements, that many times it's a discouragement to others. And I want you to see, this is the sad part, they really thought they were right. They really thought that they were the ones that were correct. Verse 12, and after that he appeared in another form unto two of them. Now this, I believe in the Gospel of Luke, is given as the two that went on the road to Emmaus. And it even says that he hid them himself from them. And then after that time, in the little room that they rented, it says that he revealed himself to them. Now, well, what a wonderful blessing, what a powerful statement that, number one, he can change forms. Did you ever think about that? Christ changing forms. He can do that. And you know, when he finally reappeared, and we'll get to that in a minute, he was back in the form that they knew. He has the ability to do that. And if he had the ability then, certainly now he still has the same abilities, does he not? And certainly he would. And so we find then these two brethren on the road to Emmaus have this wonderful experience. And as they walked, they went into the country and they went and told it into the residue. Neither believed they them. Again, unbelief. And if you know that from the Gospel of Matthew's accounting, it said that they went at night. They were so excited about seeing the Lord Jesus. They were so excited about having felt His presence once again. It says they rose in the night and ran back to Jerusalem. And when they got there, no one believed them. You're talking about discouraging. You talk about letting the wind out of your sails. And you know what? Many times today, we can have similar experiences. In fact, we can be the Oedipus of those experiences. And all of it was this caused by unbelief. Have you ever had a wonderful experience with the Lord, and you go back and you tell somebody, and that dull, you know, look like this comes back on them? You know what that is? It's unbelief. That's really what it is. Everybody says, well, I wasn't there, I don't understand it. No. What it is unbelief. Amen. That's what it is. And so we see then this morning that we need to be more than that. And when someone says, you know what? My heart burned within me because I felt the presence of the Lord. Our answer should be, amen. I agree. these two brethren and Mary, the one that washed the Lord Jesus' feet, came back to non-believers. Verse 13. Verse 14. And afterward he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief. Now I want you to see from your text, be very careful, it did not say for their unbelief. It says with their unbelief. And there's a huge difference. You know what? That means he had to say, listen, what level of belief do you have? What level of trust? You know, that means he recounted them. Mary came back and said he's risen, and you didn't believe. The two men, the two disciples that went over to Arimathea, they came back and you didn't believe. Have you ever, and listen, as wonderful as grace is, we will stand before Christ and give and stand in judgment. And you know what? I'm fearful of this. Many times, he will upbraid us for our unbelief. Now, I personally believe the apostles were saved except for Judas Iscariot. I believe way back in Matthew 16, the Lord Jesus had saved Peter. He said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." What is salvation but understanding that Christ is the Son of God? He was saved, and then we find him grouped with the 11 and chalked in with unbelief. What do you think Christ is capable of? Anything. Right? Mm-hmm. What do you think the Holy Ghost? Uh-oh, I said the word. What do you think the Holy Ghost is capable of? Anything. And you know why? Because he's just as much God as any other person's God. If we believe in a triune God, we have to believe that, do we not? Otherwise, it's inconsistent. Otherwise, we're not across the line. And so we see then that these saved people was essentially paralyzed because of their unbelief, because of their lack of confidence. Notice what it says. Because of unbelief and hardness of heart. So we find then another attachment, another piece of unbelief. It's a hard, hard heart. When you have a hard heart and you're not pliable through the things of God, your belief is compromised. Your belief is brought to a level that there's no confidence. And you know what? When you lack belief, you will not get up and go. You will not do anything for the cause of Christ because you really think it does no good anyway. And so we find here, he upbraided them for their unbelief and their hardness of heart. Listen, we live in a hard-hearted day. We really do. When people can take life and think no more about it than a piece of tissue. Listen, the barbaric practice of abortion. They want to teach our children that child within the mother's womb is no more than a piece of tissue. You know what a piece of tissue is? It's what we eat when we eat chicken and roast. That's a piece of meat tissue. You know what? Things developed and after the very image of Almighty God is more than tissue. It's more, and so we find that number one, our unbelief paralyzes us. And secondly, hardness of heart impacts how much we believe. Now notice of their hardness of heart because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. So they had a hard heart, and the result was that they did not believe. Verse 15, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, I want you to see in this as well that I believe they were saved. They were upbraided for their unbelief, but I believe that they were saved because he then immediately sends them out to preach the gospel. You know what? He don't send lost people to preach. He just doesn't. And so what that tells me as a believer, that I have a level of unbelief. Right? It has to be that way. These people were believers. These were people that actually handled and touched the very Son of God. And they still had a measure of unbelief. In fact, what did he tell Thomas on the very same instant the Gospel of Matthew? He says, "Blessed are thou, Thomas, because you have seen and believed." And then he says, "But blessed are those that believe which have not seen." Mm-hmm. And so we see then that really what motivates us, or our lack of motivation many times, is belief or non-belief. We have confidence or we don't have confidence. We understand them or we don't. Now the important thing is that you believe. Do you believe this morning? Do you believe that Jesus is the very Christ, the Son of God? Do you believe that He is able to do whatsoever He wishes, whensoever He wishes, and howsoever He wishes? That is the person of God. Do you believe that? Now, there's been many, 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 many down through the generations of time that did not believe. Go with me to the book of Jeremiah, and I will show you the undoing of such a one. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 40, and we'll begin reading in verse 14. Jeremiah 40, beginning in verse 14. Jeremiah chapter 40, beginning in verse 14, the Bible says, "And said unto him, Dost thou certainly know that Balas, the king of the Ammonites, have sent Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, to slay thee? But Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, believed them not." Now, I want you to see, in one sense, this was not necessarily concerning the gospel. But if you'll go back and read this excerpt of Jeremiah this week, what you'll find is they had been led of God to give this man a warning. You know what our responsibility to the lost, and this is our responsibility, is to give a warning. To say Christ is coming. Hell is real, and it's still hot, and it still burns with a fury, and it's still fueled by the very anger of God against those that don't believe. We're responsible to give them a warning. And so we find these two obeying the edict of God and saying, "Listen, Ishmael," and this is not Ishmael, the brother, the half-brother, but this is using the same name, and if you really follow it out, it comes from the exact same people. He was named for the father of their generations. And he says, "Listen, this man is trouble. I'm giving you fair warning this morning. Sitting in your unbelief is trouble. Being idle, saved people, is trouble. I'm giving you a fair warning. Just sitting back and doing nothing is trouble." And some people will say this, "Well, you know, I sat back and prayed." Well, that's wonderful. But you have a body like mine. You know what? We're not confined to wheelchairs. You can get up and motivate. Each and every one of us got out of the bed this morning and put on our clothes and came down to the house of God. Right? Don't tell me you can't do anything but pray. Because you know what? I don't believe you. Because you can get up and move. If it ain't nothing but to answer the door, and when the Jehovah's Witnesses are on the other side, you can tell them, "Hey, listen, you're in a mess. You're deceived and you need Christ." Right? And so we see then that these men give, and he was king at that time, give him fair warning. He said, listen, he doesn't have any interest in you. He wants to kill you. Verse 15, then Jonathan, the son of Kariah, spake to Gedaliah in Mizpah secretly, saying, let me go, I pray thee, and I will slay Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and no man shall know it. Wherefore should he slay thee, that all the Jews which were gathered unto thee should be scattered, and the remnant of Judah? But Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, said unto Johanan, the son of Kareah, thou shalt not do this thing, for thou speakest falsely of Ishmael. Now I want you to get this. He says, listen, we don't have to have a war. We don't even have to have a battle. I'll just slip in him, and I'll kill him, and I'll protect you in the process. And he says, no, I don't believe it. Ishmael is not that way. You've got it wrong. You know what? Sometimes when we go, people will just not believe. And he was cutting straight with them. He was trying to warn this man. And he says, man, Ishmael's my buddy. You're lying. But his unbelief was to his own undoing. His lack of belief killed him. In that sense, it wasn't even really Ishmael that killed him. It was his own stupidity. Right? It was his own lack of confidence in the warning. And this morning, I'm giving you a fair warning. The end is near. You know what? I rejoice that Hillary Clinton is not in the White House, but it does not change my thought patterns. The end is near, and I'm giving you fair warning. You need to believe. You need to believe. You need to trust Him. You need to have confidence in the person of the Lord Jesus. Reading on into chapter 41. Now it came to pass in the seventh month that Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, the son of Elishama, of the seed royal, and the princes of the king, even 10 men with him, came unto Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, to Mizpah, and there they did eat bread together in Mizpah. Then arose Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and the 10 men that were with him, and smote Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, with the sword, and slew him, whom the king of Babylon had made governor over the land. So, what happened to the one that lacked belief? He died in his unbelief, did he not? He was warned, and he was warned, and he was warned, and he died in his unbelief. You know what? Belief will get you moving, and unbelief will keep you right where you're at. Belief will put some feet and some going along on you, and unbelief will paralyze you and leave you right where you're at. And the author of unbelief is Satan himself. Now, you think about to the very first sin in the garden. Why did Eve do what she did? Because, and everybody said, well, you know, the Satan beguiled. That was her excuse, wasn't it? Satan hath beguiled me. You know what the real problem was? The real problem was this. She didn't believe. She didn't think God would make full on His promise, right? It was unbelief. It wasn't the serpent. Now she, you know, and you know, I don't remember, I know it used to be a saying, I think maybe it grew from a song, the devil made me do it. No, the devil didn't make you do it. What made you do it was unbelief. That's what made us do it. And so we see then in this time that unbelief has always been a problem. Go with me way back to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 15. We'll look a little bit about Abraham. Genesis 15 and verse 6. The Bible says, and he, speaking of Abraham, believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Now, most people will misquote this verse, and they will say, and he believed God, and it was counted unto him as righteousness. But the Bible says, and he believed in God. See, salvation hasn't changed. Salvation has always been the same. You know why Abraham was saved? He believed in God. He didn't just believe God. He believed in God. And you know how you're still saved this morning? Believe in God. Now, I understand no grace grows it, but believe in God. So my question to you this morning, do you believe in God? And a lot of people say, do you believe in Christ? And I understand that fully. But you know what? If you don't believe in Christ, you really don't believe in God either. Do you believe in the Holy Ghost? I do. And if I deny Him, I'll have to deny God and deny Christ too, will I not? And there's a lot of branches of so-called Christian religion out there that not only don't believe in the Holy Ghost, they make fun of the Holy Ghost. You know what? I'll have to say this. They don't believe in none of them. Because if you deny one, you deny them all. Right? And so we see there that we, as the Lord's people today, we're not motivated by self. We're not motivated, but we're where we're at because of belief. You get up and you go because of belief. You sit on your seat of do-nothing because of unbelief, right? And so I ask you this morning, where do you stand? You say, well, Brother Larry, I'm not sure. Christians, are you motivated? Are you like the 11 in the upper chamber that had to be rebuked, that had to be upbraided? Now, you can look at that meaning of upbraided, and I didn't want to get into that too deeply for time's sake. But what is the first syllable in upbraided? Up, right? I went to W.T. Thomas. Up. You know what? He didn't knock them down, did he? He upbraided them. He says, yes, you've messed up. Yes, you need to believe on me. And the next time you do believe on me, the next time when you become before the adversary, you believe on me. And you know what came a result out of that? The day of Pentecost. And you know why? Because of belief. You know why Paul rebuked Peter to his face? Because of belief. You know, Paul had been convinced of some things, had he not? He knew there was no difference between the Jew and the Greek. But his belief made him verbal about it. Right? And I have to come to this. Peter's unbelief made him cave into the Jews. Right? And so we see then that we as the Lord's people in the modern age, probably what paralyzes us more than the approaching of the end time and the coming of Christ, more than what paralyzes us than our stage in history is unbelief. I would say that's the paralyzer, would you not? I would say, you know why this house isn't full this morning? Because of unbelief. You know why our world is in such a mess today? Because of unbelief. Do you know why we have men in public offices that denies who Christ was? Because of unbelief. You know why we have children in a level of rebellion more than any time in history? It's because of unbelief. It's because don't give me this, oh, it's just the generation that we live in. You know what that is? That's a bunch of trash. What it is you don't believe that there's a God that will make you accountable. That's what it is. It's because of unbelief. But dear friend, let me tell you this, one day you will be accountable. Look with me in the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter number 9, verse 23. Deuteronomy 9, verse 23. The Bible says this, "Likewise, when the Lord sent you from Kadesh Barnea, saying, 'Go up and possess the land which I have given you,' then you rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God, and you believed not, nor hearkened to his voice." Now, I want you to see what unbelief will get you. It says they believed not, which is unbelief. And they had come to the place of Kadesh Barnea, and that was different than the place that one day that they would make their entrance into the land at the fence walls of Jericho. This would have been an easier approach if they believed God. But they didn't. They abided in unbelief. It says, because you believed not. You didn't think it was possible. You didn't think that your God, was able. You did not believe, and so you sat there and do nothing and could care less because you believed not. I want you to see also that grows out of unbelief is rebellion. What does it say? It says you hearken not. Hearken not means lack of obedience. It means not only lack of hearing, but lack of obedience. So you know why people are disobedient today? Because lack of belief. You know what? I fully believe God's going to come down and judge one day. Don't you? I fully believe, and I'll keep my eyes on the eastern sky because I believe He's coming. I believe He's coming. He's near. And so I would go on that way. But these rebellions in the day of the deliverance from Egypt, they didn't believe. And because they didn't believe, their actions were consistent with it. Their actions showed that they lacked belief. Their actions showed that they had no confidence in the ability of God. And I do want you to lastly see that lack of belief is rebellion. It says, and they rebelled. So your lack of belief this morning, we have to come to this conclusion, is rebellion. It's rebellion against God. It's rebellion against that God. Yes, in fact, God is able. Go with me to the book of Isaiah. Very familiar verse of scripture, but sometimes I think we miss the boat on it. Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53, in the very first verse. Wonderful question. Who hath believed our report? Now, what is a report? You know what? When the 10 spies were sent into the land, or the 12 spies were sent into the land the first time, and they came back and said, "We can't do it. There's no way." But there were two men, Caleb and Joshua, said, "Let's go in and let's take it right now." And no one believed their report. You know what? I'm giving you a report today. Christ is coming. I'm giving you a report this morning that He is still able. I'm giving you a report this morning. He still saves sinners. Do you believe it? And if you do, what does it motivate you to do? And if it motivates you to do nothing, you don't believe. Oh, Brother Larry, you're judging. No, Isaiah gave a report. And you know what? If you'll follow this, no one believed Isaiah either. It prompted Israel to do nothing. They weren't shook up. They weren't upset. And because of that, they went into bondage to the Babylonians for many years. Because why? They didn't believe the report. Who had believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? I'm giving you a fair report this morning. The Lord still saves.
He's still the author of salvation. He still speaks to people. He still saves. Do you believe me or do you not? Last place in the book of Psalms. Psalms chapter 27. Psalms 27, and we'll begin reading in verse 8. Psalms 27, and verse 8, the Bible says, "When thou saidest, seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek." And this is a psalm of David. And notice the Lord spoke to him and said, "Seek my face." David said, "Thy face will I seek." You know what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying? Seek my face. Search me out. Look for me. You know, you say, "Well, Brother Larry, that's Armenian." No, it's not. The Bible says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found." So then it has to be consistent with Scripture, does it not? So I'm telling you, when David heard from God, he began to seek him. You know what God is saying today? Seek my face. Seek me in salvation. Seek me to be in my perfect will. Seek me. You know what? There's not a person under the sound of my voice that's arrived, including self. So what I need to continue to do is seek the Lord. What I need to continue to do is to be sure that I'm in the center of His will, as close as I can be. And you know what? I really have sought out in the Scriptures, and I don't know in this present flesh if we can be in the center of His will, but we can be a lot closer than we are. You see what I'm saying? And I really believe with the hindrances of this flesh, I don't think it's possible. Maybe occasionally. You know what? One person I believe was in the center of God's will was old Stephen. And you know what happened to him. Right? I believe he's in the very center of God's will. And so we find then that we as the Lord's people, we must believe. We must have confidence. Verse 9 says, "Hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation." When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Oh, what a wonderful blessing. You know what? At times, you're going to be forsaken by friends, falsely so called. Because if they're friends, they want your spiritual benefit. They want you to be at your very level best between you and the Lord. And if they don't, they're not your friends. Verse 11, "Teach me thy way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies." Now, I want you to notice a couple of things. First of all, David makes this request. "Lead me in the plain path." Now, was he wanting a life of plainness? You know, when they looked for David, they said he was plain. Was it just because he was an ordinary guy? Or was he wanting, because it's the very same spelling of the word, and I did not look it up, did he want flat and level? That's a plain, right? Very few places in Stewart County that's a plain. But if you head back over toward Adam, where Adam and Sarah live, that's as close as you're going to get to a plain in Stewart County. Just level for acres and acres and acres. Was that what David was requesting? I don't want no hills. I don't want no valleys. I don't want no mountains. I don't know. But I will say this, if that's what David was requesting, he did not, nor will he ever get it. And you won't either. It's not going to be easy. But I believe he's able. It's not going to be a bed of roses, but I believe he's able.
I believe that God is exactly who He says He is, and I don't want to be hindered because of my unbelief. Verse 12, deliver me not over into the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe cruelly. I had fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You know what? If I didn't believe that, I would give up. I believe that we're going to see God in the land of the living. Now, I don't think we're going to see Him bodily, and I believe I have scripture for that. But I believe I see Him every day. I believe when the sun comes up from the east side toward Clarksville, I believe we're seeing in the land of the living. I believe when Donna tells me about a newborn baby and all went well, I believe we're seeing in the land of the living. Don't you? When I saw Sister Joanne come back from a stroke, and you literally can't tell she ever had one, and believe me, as a healthcare worker, that's unbelievable. I mean, it really is. My father, my grandfather had one at 62, and he was never the same. His mouth was twisted. His arm was like this. I believe, don't you? I believe He's able. I believe He does whatever He wishes. My question to you this morning is, do you believe? Do you believe God is still in the saving business? I believe it. I believe He still redeems people. I believe He still pulls people unto Himself. I believe it. I believe Christ is the author of salvation. Do you really believe on Him? I mean, really, have you been saved? Do you believe He's the very living Son of God and this entire world is in the palm of His hand? Do you believe?